Once upon a time, there was a population of organisms which became very poisonous by releasing an enormous quantity of toxic gas into the atmosphere, rendering it unsustainable for most of life on the planet at the time. They were responsible for the end of thousands, if not millions, of life forms. What was the harmful gas? Oxygen.
Somewhere between 2.5 and 3.5 billion years ago, there was a burst of oxygen released in the early atmosphere that killed most of anaerobic bacteria. These organisms cannot live in the presence of oxygen, and this event caused the first mass extinction that the Earth has ever saw. Over 90% of the living things on Earth were wiped out.
Although it's still unclear why exactly this happened, the main theory is that around that time, a particular kind of bacteria called cyanobacteria figured out a way to obtain energy from sunlight and carbon dioxide, but with a downside, the creation of a very poisonous waste product, oxygen. Photosynthesis was born.
Without this crucial event, life would have never rearranged the metabolic strategies that then put itself to an oxygen-breathing path towards complexity. We wouldn't be here if this didn't happen.
These cyanobacteria were then swallowed whole by some other bacterium in a process called endosymbiosis, creating the ancestors of plant cells. And these cyanobacteria became what we know today by the name of chloroplasts, the energy-producing parts of these cells.
This event is now known in biology as the Great Oxidation Event, or oxygen catastrophe, and it is likely to have caused the first and longest ice age, which lasted several hundred million years. This is because oxygen is not a so-called greenhouse gas, unlike CO2, which was a major component of the atmosphere at the time. A greenhouse gas, by the way, is a gas that traps heat onto the surface of the planet. A similar change in the atmosphere is happening right now, but in reverse. Human beings exist on this planet since some 250 to 100,000 years, and in the past 150 years or so, we released enormous quantities of greenhouse gases into the atmosphere.
Because it puts rich conditioners in your hair as you spray, and holds better than ever.
These gases include chlorofluorocarbons, nitrous oxide, water vapor, and of course methane and carbon dioxide. The major problem with these molecules is that they prevent the heat that would normally be reflected by the surface of the Earth to exit into space, creating a sort of blanket over the Earth, and this is a very big problem. Some parts of the world are already experiencing the effects of global warming. Hurricane Irma, Hurricane Harvey, South Asia floods, and East Africa droughts are just some of the examples. Not to mention some previously uncontaminated habitats and ecosystems around the world that are changing drastically.
Human-induced climate change is creating a plethora of ecosystem problems. First of all, it's warming the Earth, of course.
Plants are growing further north because they're now able to sustain life there. Migration patterns of countless species under and above water have shifted. Sea levels are rising everywhere with the risk of submerging a lot of places in the next few hundred years. Sea currents are rearranging and oceans themselves are becoming warmer and more acidic,
rendering them impossible to sustain life for a lot of species that are becoming extinct or that are on the way to do so. According to WWF's recent report, reptiles and amphibia were reduced by a whopping 60% between 1970 and 2014 by human behavior alone.
Seaweed that produce 80% of the oxygen we breathe is slowly but incessantly dying, along with corals that are crucial for the submarine ecosystems.
And global warming is not the only issue. Human pollution extends beyond just air pollution.
Microplastics, for example, are really tiny bits of plastic that are literally in the food we eat. In a very recent study, we found out that nearly 90% of the salt we eat contains microplastics.
And the worst part is, we don't even know how harmful for us or other organisms they really are.
Another problem is meat consumption. Now, I love meat, along with many other people and animals.
But the mass production of meat for humans is the cause of nearly 20% of our contribution in CO2 levels in the atmosphere.
Don't worry though, there are solutions to this problem. For instance, some scientists were recently been able to multiply cells taken by lambs, creating the same meat without hurting any animal, and reducing CO2 emissions by 99%.
But until this research becomes more popular and adopted by the biggest food companies around the world, the problem will persist. Remember when we used to say that pollution is going to destroy the planet? Well, it is happening right now, right here. And it's not really much about the planet at all. The planet is fine. The planet saw rivers of lava, incredible meteor showers. The planet is fine. What we're talking here is us. Global warming is going to destroy us, is going to end humans.
A very recent estimation by the IPCC says that in about 11 years, the global average temperature will rise for about 1.5 degrees Celsius globally. You think 1.5 degrees is not that much, huh? Well, think again. In 1816, following very powerful volcanic events that happened around the world, substantial amount of atmospheric dust built up, rendering that year the coldest year in recent history. It is now known as 1800 and froze to death.
Or more famously, the year without a summer.
An intense wave of famine and disease followed this event, because the cold killed most of the crops and 200,000 people died as a result.
And that year, global average temperature dropped by 0.7 degrees Celsius. The rise in temperature of 1.5 degrees is gonna be disastrous, and it is the least pessimistic scenario. By the way, the same report says that in about 80 years, temperature will be 3 degrees greater.
So Obama's talking about all of this with the global warming and that, and a lot of it's a hoax. It's a hoax. I mean, it's a money-making industry, okay? It's a hoax.
In the meantime, some of the world's most powerful right-wing leaders are denying the human involvement in climate change. And some of them are even denying that climate change is even real. When in fact, it is, of course.
Some of them do this for economic interest, while some just really can't understand the implications and the possible consequences of their foolish, foolish statements.
Jair Bolsonaro, the new elected president of Brazil, is determined to exploit the Amazon forest despite environmental protection, and was even determined to backtrack from the Paris Agreement, before changing his mind after backlash from his own electorate. In Italy, far-right Minister of the Interior Matteo Salvini never expressed himself on the subject, except when he confused the climate change immigration phenomenon with immigration. In the United States, many Republicans are denying the human involvement in global warming, and the President Donald Trump tweeted skepticism about it more than 100 times before publicly announcing his will to withdraw from the Paris Agreement as soon as he can do that in 2019.
This is crazy. Denying climate change in 2018 is like not believing AIDS exists. It's just stupid and dangerous, and again, is also economically convenient for some people who thrive by selling fossil fuels.
In the modern developed world, some 80% of all the electricity is created by the burning of fossil fuels. Transforming heat into electricity is a very ineffective way to create energy, because the heat spreads out pretty quickly, rendering it useless.
For example, here in Italy, 60% of the energy is created through the burning of coal, while around the world, renewable sources are accounted for 20% of the energy output. Which is a bit weird if you think about it, since we have an actual giant nuclear power station right there, free for everybody to use.
If we were able to take all the sun's energy released on land in 1 second, turn it into current, and then put it in a giant battery, we could survive for more than 20,000 years. And if we cover 1% of the area of the Sahara Desert with solar panels, we could easily produce free energy for the whole planet. Forever. Iceland is one of the greenest countries in the world. About 65% of the energy is geothermal, about 20% is hydropower, and just only 50% is fossil fuel derived.
The goal of countries like Iceland, Sweden, Germany, but even Costa Rica and Nicaragua is to be 100% renewable. And honestly, it should be the primary concern of every country. But for many, many nations, we're very far away from that. And until oil and coal will be used up, many governments will never seriously look into renewable energy at all.
For this reason, many investors are actually financing ways to dodge the problem. For instance, many countries are seriously preparing for underground life by studying ways to make solar light penetrate into Earth's crust more effectively, to allow plants to thrive and to enable us to actually live underground.
Hopefully, this is a faraway possibility. And while you can push this future away by saving energy and by recycling, the big step have to be taken by the governments of every country, which should push and invest the research for renewable energy to make it cheaper and more fruitful. We are living in a very dark time of our history, and if we don't do something about it,
the tornadoes will keep becoming stronger, the floods more and more recurring, and the oceans will keep rising.
We have to be all banded together, every country side by side, to make our home habitable by everyone and everything. To leave things as we found them. To make Earth great again. Thank you.